So first, thank you very much for the invitation and giving me the opportunity to speak here. So here I will be talking about some geometric methods in order to study concurrent programs. So since I wasn't sure about who was going to be in the audience, I decided to go for a very simple talk explaining the motivations, and you will see maybe more applications of this or more advanced topics in Martin Rausen's talk. So, okay. So here we are interested in concurrent programs, so this means programs constituting of multiple threads which run in parallel, and so the general idea here is that we want to model their state space, which is the space of all the possible executions that those programs can have. And what I try to advocate here is that geometric models can be useful because you can see those state space as some kind of geometric structure, and trying to find invariant with this point of view is quite interesting and useful. Okay, and a typical application of this work would be verification of programs. So here you want to guarantee that the program can never go wrong, and by this you can think of that the program will never divide by zero or raise an exception or do call an impossible operation. And also we will concentrate on problems which are, so this kind of problem is already present for any program you can use, but I will also concentrate on problems which are more specific to concurrent programs, so programs with multiple threads. Okay, so so here I will be presented various flavors of geometric models, so they range from algebraic, so some kind of graphs with more structure maybe, to topological flavors, so some topological spaces, but I all call them under the name of geometric models. So why are they interesting? So first, they provide a way to visualize the state space, and this might seem to be a little thing, but actually it's quite already quite interesting because since you can visualize things, you can come up with new ideas and some algorithms were actually devised because of these ways of thinking of programs. The other thing is that we can use geometric invariants and constructions. So you can think of homotopy between paths or maybe homology or stuff like this. And so we want to try to apply classical geometric invariants to this kind of space arising from programs. But actually this is not so easy because these spaces are not plain topological spaces. You have to take in account the direction of time. So actually it has motivated the introduction of a variant of topological spaces which are called directed topological spaces, which take times in account. And so this raises new questions in geometry or in algebraic topology, and you have to adapt and make new mathematical development for this. Okay, so a typical example would be like this. So for a connected space X, one usually considers a fundamental group, which is a group of loops starting from a point X to itself. Then maybe if your space is not connected, or if you want to see things more in more details, you want to consider the fundamental groupoid, which means you have a category with all the points of the space as objects, and the morphisms are passed from one point to the other point up to homotopy. And for a directed space, the path won't be necessarily reversible, which means that you can go from, maybe you can go from X to Y, but not from Y to X. So actually, you have not always a groupoid, but you have a fundamental category. And then you can start to study things from this point of view. Okay. So other invariants have to be generalized similarly, and this is not obvious. So there is no, for instance, no clear consensus of what should be a homotopy equivalent and so on. Okay. So again, here I will focus on very simple geometric aspects, and since this spring school is about algebraic topology, I won't be going into very much details about verification. It's more motivation in this talk. Okay, so let me first talk about sequential programs, so programs with one thread executing. So when you study a sequential program, people usually use already a geometric description, which is very simple. It's called a control flow graph, so it's a graph describing all the possible executions of the program. So let's start by an example. So let's look at this example. So here you say x I put 5 in the cell x, and then while x is different from 1, I look whether x mod 2 is 0 or not, and if it's not 0, then I multiply x by 3 and add 1, and maybe if it's not 0, then I divide it by 2, and then in the end I say okay, I reach 1. So then this program might be represented as a graph as follows. So here you will see that you have some vertices and edges are labeled either by the instruction of the program or by Boolean conditions. So dotted edges are labeled by conditions. So here I check whether x is equal to 1 or not. And also, this graph has two distinguished vertices. So there is a starting vertex S here, and a target vertex T here. And the path in this program corresponds to execution of the program. So for instance, maybe I start with x equal 5. Then I verify that x is different from 1. Then I verify whether maybe x mod 2 is different from 0. Then I execute x gets 3 times x. Then I execute x gets incremented. Then maybe this gets true. And then I print reach 1. Okay. So here the paths correspond to execution of the program. But actually, not all paths correspond to execution because you have to verify in a path that these conditions are satisfied. So maybe this path here is not a valid path because here I put 5 in x, and then I check that I don't have x different from 1, which is not the case because x equals 5, so it's not 1. So this path here is not a possible execution. Okay. I will start with a very simple language. So in this language you have arithmetic expressions, so you have variables, integers, maybe addition, multiplication. You have another syntactic category which is Boolean expressions, so you have true, false, and comparison and Boolean operators. Okay. Then you have what I call here actions, so these are things which actually do something. So here, a variable gets the value computed from some arithmetic expression, or maybe I can print an arithmetic expression. And then I have commands or programs, which are either actions, or sequence of actions, or conditional branching, so I test whether a Boolean expression is true or not, and then I execute one or two, or loops, okay, conditional loops. Okay, so how do I associate a graph to such a program? So a graph consists of a set G0 of vertices, a set G1 of edges, and two maps from edges to vertices, indicating the source and the target of an edge. And for control flow graph, you have a little bit more. First, you have a beginning target S, a beginning vertex S, and an end vertex S. And you have also a labeling function, which to every edge associates either an action or a Boolean expression. Okay, so just as in previous example. Okay, so now how do I associate a graph to a program? I do it by induction on the structure of the program. So for instance, to an action A, I just associate the graph with two vertices, the beginning and the end, and one edge which is labeled by the action. Then, how do we interpret the sequence? Well, if I have a graph corresponding to P, a graph corresponding to Q, here I will just take this end vertex here and identify it with the source vertex here. So the graph corresponding to GPQ will be this one. Then the if-then-else will look like this. So I will add a new vertex and an edge saying, okay, maybe B is true, and then I will do this graph, or maybe not B is true, and I will do this graph, and I amalgamate the two endpoints. And the while is similar, so you do GP and you loop. So you start from here, you do GP, and you loop while B is true, and in the end, maybe not B is true, and then you go to another state, okay? Okay, so I don't want to spend too much time on this because this is really not completely, oh, this is classical, let's say. I want to focus more on the geometric part. And here, an execution path for a program is a path starting from the starting vertex, so something like this, and so on. Okay. So now, how do I actually specify what the program does? I do it by introducing a denotational semantics, which means I interpret the action of the program into some set. So first, I say that a state here is an element of this set here. So this set is the set of functions from the set of variables. So I suppose that I have a definite set of variables. And to each variable, I can associate an integer. Okay. So here, I consider that my program only manipulates integers for simplicity. So now we can define the semantics by interpreting each arithmetic expression as a function bracket A to the set of states to Z. So it means that whenever I am in this state, in a given state here, this arithmetic expression will evaluate to this integer. So for instance, if I have a state sigma, so sigma is a function from variable to Z, where sigma of x is 2, the interpretation of x plus 3 will be defined as the interpretation of x plus the interpretation of 3. The interpretation of 3 is always 3, but the interpretation of x depends on sigma, so here it is a sigma of x, and here since sigma of x is 2, it will be 5. Okay? So in this way, by induction, I can interpret every arithmetic expression. Similarly, every Boolean expression gets interpreted as a function from state to Boolean, so this is false and this is true. And each action is now interpreted as a function from the state to from state to state. So an action transforms states. So for instance, the action x get a, when I apply it to a state sigma here, I get a new state here, and this new state will to a variable associate a natural an integer, and to a variable y it will associate the result of evaluating A in sigma if y is x, and it will get unchanged otherwise. So I just change the value for x, and I replace it by the interpretation of A. Okay, and other construction can be interpreted similarly. So for the sequence, I just compose the actions, if then else is what you expect, and so on. Okay, so now. Once I have defined in this way the semantics of each program, it can be extended to execution paths, because essentially an execution path is just a sequence of instructions. So I know how to interpret a sequence of instructions. So I know how to define the semantics of a path. Okay. And now I can say that an execution path is valid when the Boolean conditions are satisfied. So this means that whenever I have a path like this, I have a path, for instance, reaching this point here, so this path here. I know in which state I'm going to be here. And now, if I encounter an edge labeled by a Boolean condition, I can check whether or not it will hold. And I will say that a path is valid when this Boolean condition holds. So it means that this path is valid because x is different from 1 in this state, because x gets 5. But this path is not valid because the Boolean condition is not satisfied. Okay, and now when we want to verify programs, we have so there are many ways to do this, but one way to do this is to distinguish a set of vertices which are error vertices, and you say that a program is correct when there is no valid execution path which can reach an error vertex. So for instance, maybe if you don't want to divide by zero, then you can modify your program just a bit. So you say if x is equal to zero, then I get an error. Otherwise, y is the inverse of x. And in this branch, you will have a bad vertex here, and you say that you don't want to reach this bad vertex here. Okay. Yeah. No. Okay, so do you have a question? Or? Okay, so don't hesitate to ask questions if you have. Maybe I switch. Okay, so no, this is what I wanted to see if you were following or not. Okay, so of course you want to make sure that x is never zero, so that this vertex is not reachable. So here it's obvious, but it might be a part of a big graph. Okay, and so this is again very classical in some sense. So there are many techniques to see whether a vertex is reachable or not, and this is not easy because you can have loops, which means that you can have a path of arbitrary length, so you cannot just test all paths, and you can have infinite sets of possible values. So maybe when you start your program, you don't know what is the value for x, or maybe you know that the user will enter a value from 0 to 10, you don't know which one. Or so reachability is actually undecidable. But in practice, there are standard techniques which work well, such as abstract interpretation. So you know how to modify the semantics in order to handle sets of value and so on. Okay, so I won't say much more about this, but just to say that okay, people know more or less how to deal with this kind of problems today. Okay, so yeah. Yes. So another point of view on verification is maybe you want to see that you don't reach bad states, but another point of view is that you want to ensure that in whichever execution some invariants are preserved. So another way to consider verification is to consider the path from the beginning to the end and make sure that in all these paths some invariant is preserved. So for instance, if you are on a plane, you want to know that the wing, you won't turn the wing or whatever. So you know that the values for the motor of the wing is between 0 and 10, and you want to ensure that this is always the case. Okay. So for this reason, the set of this path from the beginning to the end is particularly important because this is the set of all possible executions, and it is interesting, and it's called the trace space. And actually, the terminology space here, it suggests that it has more structures than just a mere set, and I will come back to this later. Okay, so now I want to switch to concurrent programs, which are what is interesting for me. So a concurrent program is a program just as before, but now I add a new instruction, which is the parallel composition. So P parallel Q means that I run P and Q in parallel. Okay, so I have two threads, or maybe two computers, one executing P and the other one executing Q. Okay, and so I will do here. I will always do an assumption, which is called sequential consistency, and which says that the possible behaviors of P parallel Q are all the possible interleaving of the actions of P and the actions of Q. So let's do an example. So for instance, if I consider this program. So here x1 gets 1 and y1 gets x2, and then it's executed in parallel with another program which says that x2 gets 1 and y2 gets x1, so x1 here. And sequential consistency says that the possible execution of this program are all the possible interleavings of this program. So here this means that if you project on the red part, you will get this program. If you project on the blue part, you will get this program here. Okay. So possible execution is this one, for instance, which means that this thread, for some reason, gets executed first, and then this thread gets executed. Okay. So you can observe that this execution corresponding to interleaving of the two processes correspond exactly to the path in this graph here. And so this suggests that there is a possible construction corresponding to the parallel when we look at control flow graphs. Okay, so I will get back to this. But I want to mention something also, which is that in practice, this assumption, so it might seem to be obvious to most of you that this is all the possible executions of this program, but if you look in actual processors, this is not the case. So in fact, Today, nowadays, processors have what is called weak memory model, and because of this, you can even have y1 equals 0 and y2 equals 0. So if you look at this, you see that you say that you think that it is impossible because there is a first instruction executed, so it's maybe it's this one, so it means that x1 will get 1, or maybe the first instruction is this one, which means x2 will get 1. And so it's impossible that if it's x1 which gets 1, in the end y2 will be 1 because it's equal to the value of x1. And similarly, if x2 gets 1 first, then the value of y1 will be 1. But actually, because there are cache problems and so on, so processors are designed in a very peculiar way, you can even have this result. So it's really an assumption, and you can test it. Okay, so this is a program, and if you run it, so you have to run it a million of times because usually you won't see that, but in some rare cases, the semantics says that this is possible, and actually you can see that it is possible. Okay, so I'm just saying this to say that this is actually an assumption and to motivate some construction that we will need later on. Okay, so. All this suggests that we define the graph corresponding to P parallel Q as the tensor product of the graph GP and GQ. So how do I define this tensor product? Well, this tensor product, the vertices of P parallel Q is the product of the vertices of P and the vertices of Q. And an edge in this tensor product is either it's a pair constituting of an edge in P and a vertex in Q, or a vertex in P and an edge in Q with the expected source and target. Okay, so the source and target consists in taking the source and target on the component which has an edge. So for instance, if I consider this graph here, so it corresponds to it's the control flow graph of a program doing two actions here. And I tensor with another graph like this, I will get this as a tensor product. So here, the vertices are pair of vertices. So here I have x, which is a vertex here, and x prime, which is a vertex here. Okay, I write tensor, but it is really a pair here. And an edge here, for instance, it's an edge e in this graph, and a vertex here in this graph. Okay, and maybe you have the other situation in here. So this corresponds to all the, and the paths in this graph are all the possible interleaving of the two graphs, of the two processes, so it's the right way to interpret the parallel construction. Okay, so now that we have done this, in theory, we could do just as before. So now we have the control flow graph for programs which use a parallel construction, and we can apply previously mentioned techniques. But in practice, this is really not feasible because of what is called the state space explosion problem. So given a program P of size K, if I consider P in parallel with P in parallel with P in parallel with P, so its graph will be this tensor product, and the size of this graph is k to the n, so it means that it's exponential in the number of processes. So in practice, there is really an explosion in the size of the control flow graph, which makes that impossible to verify programs which are not very, very small. Okay. Okay, so this suggests that maybe we should take in account more information in the control flow graph, and this is what we are going to do. Okay. One way to get out of this problem is to consider commutation between actions, and we will see that this commutation between actions actually do provide some kind of surfaces in control flow graphs, and that forbidden region create holes. So I will explain this. So in order to face the state explosion problem, people have observed that some actions do commute. So what do I mean by this? For instance, if you look at the two threads of this program, the actions commute. This means that if I execute x get 1 and y gets 2, or if I execute y gets 2 and x get 1, in the end, I always get into the same state, which is a state in which x is 1 and y is 2. So the order in which the two instructions are executed is not relevant. Okay. So in the following, we are going to indicate this by adding some kind of surface in here. So we will consider this square as filled, because here these two paths are equivalent in the sense that they give rise to the same result. And this is how this is the point of view we are going to adopt. Okay, but of course, some actions do not commute. So, for instance, if I do x gets 1 and x gets 2, it doesn't commute with the other scheduling, because in the end, x can, if I follow this path, x is 2 in the end, and if I follow this path, x is 1 in the end. Okay. And another reason why commutation is important is that we want our semantics to be stable under refinement. What do I mean by this? So the semantics of A in parallel with B is this square. Okay. But now you want to have some kind of modularity when you study programs, and maybe A is not one single instruction, but it turns out that this instruction is implemented by a sequence of instructions, so for instance, a sequence of two instructions. But now, if I take this graph and I replace A by the A1 followed by A2, so I obtain a graph like this, this is not the semantics I would obtain by computing the semantics of A1 followed by A2 in parallel with B, because there is a possibility of having an edge here, okay? So this really means that in order to have a compositional semantics, I need to have some more information here, and I need to have the information that these two actions do commute, so that I know that I have to add an extra transition here, okay? So having some committing instruction and not committing instruction, knowing in which case we are, is important. Okay, and this idea of taking commutations is called true concurrency, and it was studied for a long time. But in the beginning, so people took in account the commutation of two actions, but there is no reason why we should really stop at two, and maybe we can take in account the commutation of three actions or more. So here, the commutation of two actions is indicated by a field square, and then if we follow this idea, the commutation of three actions should be indicated by a field cube, so I will have maybe a field or an empty cube, and so on. Okay. So this means that now I want my control flow graphs are not going to be graphs anymore, but are going to be what is called pre-cubical sets. So a pre-cubical set consists for every natural number of a set Cn whose elements are called n cubes, and we have face maps. So before we had only source and target for edges, but now an n cube has n face maps, so here the faces are indexed by dimension which go from 0 to n, to n minus 1, so an n cube has n face maps, and actually it has twice n face maps, because it's also indexed by the alpha, which can be minus or plus, okay? So when alpha is minus, it's going to be a source in dimension e, when alpha is plus, it's going to be a target in dimension I. Okay? If you think of a cube, so here there is this cube here. There is a source. If you take this direction here, you can say that the source of this cube here is this square here, and the target of this cube here is this square here. Okay? And this is the source and target in this direction. And since in a cube you have three possible directions, you have three possible sources and targets. And you also require some commutation between face maps. So maybe it's better to see an example for this commutation. So if I have a square here, so if I take this direction here, I have a source for this square, which is this edge here. Okay? And if I take this direction here, I have a source for this x, which is this edge here. Okay? This an edge is a one cube. Now, if I take the source of the source, I get to this vertex, so vertex is a zero cube, and if I take the source in this direction and then the source, I will get this vertex also, and so in order to really have a square here, this these two operations to, should commute, which means that if I take the source here and the source here, or the source here and the source here, I get to the same vertex. So if you generalize this observation, you will get the correct commutation for the face maps. Okay. So are there any questions on this? No. Okay. So this is really a generalization of graphs, because a graph is a particular case of a precubical set where you have C0 as vertices, when C1 is a set of edges, and delta minus and delta plus are source and target maps, and you don't have cubes in higher dimension than 1. Okay, and just terminological observation. When you have a distinguished vertex, it's sometimes called also a higher dimensional automata. Okay, so now there is a tensor product on these precubical sets, which generalizes the tensor product we have seen on graphs, and it's defined like this. So the n cubes of the tensor products of C and D is the set of pairs consisting of an I cube in C and a J cube in D, such that the dimension of I and J, if you sum them up, it gives N, okay? And then you can define a boundary map, but maybe we don't want to go into such details. Okay, so for instance, if I take this graph with this graph, but I see them as a precubical set, of course, so these are two precubical sets. If I take the tensor product, I will get something like this. Okay. So, for instance, here I have a surface here, which is a pair FG. So F is a 1 cube, G is a 1 cube also. So if I take the pair of the two, it's going to give me a 2 cube. 1 plus 1 is 2. Okay. And and then I tensor I is the square. Okay, and S1 tensor S1 is this, but of course you can compute this in every dimension, but I can't picture them in higher dimensions. Okay, so this suggests that we define the cubical semantics of a program P as before. So it means that in particular for action, it's just an edge and so on. So everything remains unchanged. Excepting that I change one thing, which is the interpretation of the parallel. It's not a tensor product of graphs anymore, but it's now a tensor product of precubical sets, so that I can construct these surfaces which indicate the commutation between actions. But, okay, so this is nice, but this is too simple for now, because, for instance, the semantics of this is this field square, okay? But here, it doesn't, of course, really take in account commutation between actions. So here, I still have a square. When I take the tensor product, I always add a square between two. I always fill up square, because this is what the tensor product does. So we need somehow to carve holes, okay? So this is a good starting point, because we now have the higher dimensional surfaces, but now we need to indicate that some things actually don't commute, okay? And the way we are going to do this is inspired of the way programs are actually implemented in practice. So in practice, systems operating systems provide primitives to ensure that two threads will not access a variable at the same time. Okay, so and this is in particular because of the problem I showed you earlier. So you have some semantics which are not even sequentially consistent. So it's becoming too completely crazy to reason about such programs. So you want to ensure that actually sequential consistency is ensured. And so you have these mutexes. Okay. So what is a mutex? A mutex is so I call it A. It's some kind of resource on which you have two operations. You can lock the mutex, so you have an action which is, okay, I lock the mutex, so I take it, or I release the mutex, which is I release it. And the implementation will guarantee that at most one process can have a mutex at a given time. Okay, so if I lock the mutex and some other process tries to lock the mutex, then the other process won't go further until I release the mutex. Okay, so at any point in time, no two processes can have the same mutex. So having meaning having done a lock without having done a release. Okay. So so we need to add two actions to our language. So we have this action and this action, which correspond to taking and releasing a mutex. And so a mutex cannot be taken by two persons. So it can be taken by one person, but not by two. And sometimes it will be interesting to consider resources which have other capacities. So the capacity of a resource is the number of people which can have it at a given time. So sometimes we want to consider resources which can be taken by three people, but not by four. So at most three people can have it. Okay. But, and the mutex is a resource of capacity one, which will be the main object of interest here. Okay. So the semantics of this program here is this square here, but remember that we don't want it to be filled. So actually, since the two threads are accessing the variable x together, in practice, we should ensure that this is excluded by the discipline of mutexes. So this means that before accessing x, now we should transform this program into this one, where before accessing x, we take a mutex, and after that, we release it. And similarly for that, and so that we ensure that the two programs won't be accessing x, the variable x, at exactly the same time, and it avoids a lot of problems, including those I mentioned earlier. So this means that now, whenever I have a variable which is used by two processes, I protect it by taking a mutex and releasing it afterward. So now the semantics of my program is this. And now you can see that this vertex here is not reachable anymore, because to reach this vertex, you have to have the mutex being taken twice. So here the first process takes the mutex, and then the second process takes the mutex. But as I said earlier, it is guaranteed by the implementation in the operating system that such a situation will not happen. So actually, we should remove all these vertices, because they are forbidden by the implementation. Okay, and so the actual semantics of the program is going to be this. Okay, so we are going to start from the semantics I showed earlier, and then we are going to remove some positions which are forbidden because of these mutexes. Okay, so when we protect variables here, so protecting means that taking a mutex and releasing it after. This ensures that the two programs are mutually exclusive. So this is just terminology. So it means that they can run at the same time. So either one or the other run. And this also ensures that they are atomic here, because P cannot be interleaved with any other with Q here, because of the discipline of the mutexes. Okay. So maybe I will do this very quickly. So we say that a program is conservative when resource consumption only depends on the vertex, not on the path reaching it. So maybe I will show non-conservative program. So this program here is not conservative here, because if I take this path here, when I reach this vertex, A has been taken, but if I use this path to reach this vertex, B has been taken. So depending on the path I choose to reach the vertex, the resource consumption is not the same. For this program, for instance, it's conservative, because when I reach this point here, I have taken both B and A, and if I take this path, it is also the case. Okay, so okay, this can be defined algebraically, but you can imagine what is resource consumption. So P consumes a mutex, and V releases a mutex. Okay, and if you have a conservative program, you say that a vertex is valid when you don't have consumed a resource too much. Okay, so this means for mutex that you have not taken the mutex twice, or you have not released more than you have taken, and it's forbidden otherwise. And so here the forbidden vertices are those one. And now we say that the cubical semantics of a conservative program is the pre-cubical set CHHP, which is obtained from CP by removing all the forbidden vertices and all the cube having those forbidden vertices as iterated faces. So we should also remove this square here, this edge here, and so on. Okay. Okay. So now, given a pre-cubical set, we write a tilde for the smallest equivalence, which whenever I have a square like this, I consider that AB and B prime A prime as is equivalent. So I can define an equivalence like this on path, and I can close it under as a congruence. So it means that it's compatible with concatenation. And when you have programs which are decent enough, you can show that two equivalent paths have actually the same semantics. So this means that now our equivalence on path really correspond to the equivalence for executions. And so this means that in order to check all behavior, it's enough to check one representative in each equivalence class of executions under this equivalence. So this reduces much the state space. Okay. So So given a pre-cubical set C, we can define a fundamental category which has the vertices of the pre-cubical set as the object and the path up to this equivalence as morphisms. Okay. And this is really this category really describes all the computation up to inessential reordering of actions. And the terminology suggests that this corresponds to some form of homotopy. We'll get back to this. Okay. Maybe I will stop here. Yeah. Thank you. I think. You mean what, inserting this mutex discipline, like taking and releasing mutexes?
Yeah, like, is this, like, what could I say? I just, like, whenever I have, like, an access to variable, like, if I had a program without any P's and V's, could I insert these P's and V's from just using the program, or is there some knowledge that I need?
Yeah, so there are ways to do this automatically. But these are not necessarily efficient ways. So, for instance, one way to do this automatically would be to have one mutex, and whenever you access a variable, before accessing it, you take the mutex, and after accessing it, you release the mutex. But it doesn't depend on the name of the variables and so on. So this would be correct. So it means that it inserts enough atomic sections, but it's very bad because it removes all possible concurrency. So then you can do some finer invariants and so on. So basically, what you want to ensure is that you don't access the same variable twice. So if you have some way of doing some static analysis on the program and knowing which variables are going to be used or which variables are not going to be used, then you could do this automatically. But another answer is that actually programmers have to do this anyway. So maybe this was more a didactic presentation I tried to do here. So I said, okay, you take a program and then maybe you have to insert it. But in real life, when you analyze programs, those are already inserted. Okay. So checking that they are correctly inserted is a problem in itself, but if you assume that this is correctly done, and it is usually done, then you can you still want to analyze programs and check that there is no division by zero if you assume that they are correctly protected. So
some, let's thank Samuel again.